have two honorable members in the panel, Rita Sudowski, assistant professor of the Wirtschaftsuniversity in Vienna, and Peter Kools, judge at the Supreme Court in The Hague. Rita, ladies first, would you like to comment?
Yes, thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation also to be part of this distinguished panel and be able to reflect on these very challenging thoughts. I will try to make an overview of what we learned from Raymond's and Eric's presentation, and also including Daniel's presentation, about the status of anti-abuse rules under the stated EU stated rules and the sovereignty of the member states to introduce or not to introduce anti-abuse rules, and adding some of my personal comments on this summary. So I think what we learned is basically we can distinguish two situations where the issue of state aid can arise, and that's the lack of anti-abuse rules in a domestic system, either a general, a GAR, or the lack of specific anti-abuse rules. And the other situation is the selective application of existing anti-abuse rules. As regards the first question, the lack of a GAR or lack of certain specific anti-abuse rules in a domestic system, I recall the case of Triem Italia, where the Court of Justice held that there is no general EU law principle according to which the member states would be obliged to prevent the abuse of their domestic law. Or the circumvention of their domestic taxes. Now, if you think about that, there is no such general principle under EU law. Is it completely reconcilable with the Commission's reasoning in the tax rulings investigation cases? Because what the Commission argues is that there is a principle of equality embedded in the EU stated rules, which basically requires that the member states do not treat group companies more favorably than standalone companies. So this inherent embedded principle of equality, what is basically inferred to oblige the member states to have the arm's length principle and to apply the arm's length principle. So if that's the case, then could not we say that the same principle also requires a member state that it does not treat tax avoiders or tax cheaters in the same way as honest taxpayers? That is something also following, for me at least, from the principle of equality. So if the principle of equality requires the application of an arm's length principle under domestic law, even if it's not specifically laid down in that domestic law, could we say that the same principle from which you can derive the principle of prevention of abuse also requires a member state to put in place anti-abuse rules, either a GAR or a certain specific anti-abuse rule? Now I come to the second situation, the selective application of an existing domestic anti-abuse rule, where I would say, I think Daniel also mentioned, that here you can also have two situations when the selectivity comes from the domestic legislation itself. So there is an anti-abuse rule under domestic law, for example, the UK CFC rule, but it's drafted in a way or provided in a way under domestic law, which involves some differential treatment for certain taxpayers. And that would be the case with the UK CFC rules for group financing income. You do not apply the CFC rules in the same way as for other income. And the other situation is when the tax authorities apply an otherwise equal or neutral anti-abuse rule in a selective way. And that would be the case of the tax ruling investigations, or even if there is no written proof of that selective application, you could say that a certain tax assessment is not in line with the general rules, deviates from the general normal interpretation of the general law, and that's why it's selective. And I think in this group of cases, what we are facing with, the most essential question that we are facing with is the choice of the reference system, as we heard. And this is the crux of the matter in most of the cases, how to choose the right reference system. And this is what we saw in the case of Heidkamp, so the German loss carry forward case. And we saw the solution by the Commission, we saw the solution by the General Court, and now by the Advocate General. This was also this very, very difficult conceptual question, how to choose the reference system, was also addressed by Mr. Löwenthal. And what I gather from his presentation that probably in his view the solution would be not to have this step in the selectivity analysis at all, the derogation test, the so-called derogation test, where you have to identify a reference system, but just to do a pure discrimination test. And that, I think, it could be a way out only superficially, because I think, unfortunately, the discrimination test involves the same conceptual difficulty, and that would mean the selection of comparables. I think that is actually the same problem as the identification of the reference system. Under a discrimination test, you still have to decide what to compare with what. So you have to choose what is the general system that you compare with the derogation. So I think that the bad news is that we cannot really escape from this very difficult conceptual question under any type of analysis. And what Mr. Löwenthal also said, and Eric also criticized, that in his view, you have to take the lowest level of generality, and that's the reference system, compared to which you decide whether there is a derogation. However, in the tax ruling investigation cases, the reference system is always the general corporate income tax system, which is the highest or the more general, the most general reference system possible. So I think there is some kind of discrepancy in this reasoning. Now, the ATAD changes the picture, because now we have EU secondary law, which obliges the member states to introduce certain anti-abuse rules. If they do not do so, as Raymond says, the Commission actually can initiate an infringement procedure. So I think that brings quite uncertainty in the system, so we do not have to rely anymore, or we do not have to question anymore whether on the basis of some very general and vague principles, like the principle of equality, or on the basis of the stated rules, the member states would be somehow obliged to have this or that anti-abuse rule. Now we have secondary law which says what are the compulsory anti-abuse rules which have to be introduced to a certain tax system. But having said so, it's still not the ideal picture, because we can also question whether the ATAD itself contains some differentiations, some distinctions, which could be questionable under the stated rules. And we saw that on some of the slides, like the exceptions to the interest limitation rule, exceptions to the CFC rule, whether these distinctions which are provided for in the directive itself, in EU secondary law, can be challenged under the stated rules. Well, as Raymond mentioned, under the stated rules, probably not, because stated is granted by the member states. And this is a directive which is an EU instrument, so that cannot be stated. However, we can still ask the question, and now we are coming back again, my favorite principle, the principle of equality, whether that could be something which, on the basis of which these distinctions, differentiations within the ACAD could be challenged.